Hey, this is Jeremy Kay at Reverb.com, and today we're going to talk about how to get that Motown bass sound, how to get that James Jamerson bass tone. For those who don't know, James Jamerson was the main Motown bass player, revolutionized bass playing. So there's a couple different aspects to getting that sound. You know, there's obviously first his fantastic technique. If you've listened to those lines, there's some really excellent stuff in there. That's a lifetime study on its own. You know, the next is the bass itself, and we'll talk about how to set up your bass to approximate that sound. And lastly is the signal chain. Many people may not know that Motown did not use amps in the studio. The bass and all the guitars went direct by a special Motown DI preamp combo. You know, Motown built everything by hand. These units were never manufactured or made available for sale. So what this company, Acme, did is they tracked down the original manufacturer and original engineers and tried to source as close as possible the materials and building techniques of the original. And if you're looking to approximate the live sound, the Jamerson live tone, he used an Ampeg B15 in the clubs. If you want to mic that in the studio too, it's a great sounding amp, probably one of the most popular studio recording bass amps of all time. Just for reference, this is the bass direct into the preamp without the DI. They used P basses at Motown. It's really the only bass they ever used. So get yourself a P bass. Doesn't have to be vintage, although that doesn't hurt. And you want to get some flat wound strings. So Jamerson used heavy gauge Labella flat wound strings. I don't happen to have the heavy gauge on here. I have the Labella 760 FL, slightly lighter gauge. And you want to let your strings deaden up a bit. So when you first put on some flat wound strings, they're going to be bright, they're going to be clanky. They might not get exactly that sound, but you have to be patient with them. You have to play on them for a month or two. You know, you had pretty high action, so very clean notes with no fret buzz. You know, the final real piece of the puzzle is the foam mute. So I've got some foam stuck under my strings here, which deaden out the sound. You don't have the mute. Now, if you do have the mute, it's just a little, the decay happens faster and less overtones. Brought with me, if you've seen some old Fender gear, you know, Fender puts them on the reissues now. If you've seen a vintage Fender bass, you'll see these silver accessories. These don't necessarily really do anything sonically, although originally the bridge guard had its own little foam strip, a little rubber foam strip glued on here. This is a 67 P bass, so that's long since fallen off, but Fender does put these on some of the reissues. And you can always approximate that by, you know, re-gluing that if you want. Or if you don't want to actually have these on, you can just stick some foam under there. This doesn't change your sound at all. I always wondered about that when I was a kid, but it's just, that's pure cosmetic. The one thing it would affect James's playing technique, because he left all this stuff on, and he would just use one finger right in this position. Now that position changes your sound a little bit. Playing more towards the bridge gives you a sparklier tone. Playing more towards here gives you a just sort of mellower sound. Obviously, I'm not James Jamerson, and you're not James Jamerson, but you know, we can have a lot of fun applying his techniques to our own songs, to our own playing. Learning some of his lines is a great way to, you know, test your reading chops or listening chops or definitely your playing chops. Have fun with it. There's a great world of sound out there. Thanks so much, and see you next time.